Hello and welcome to this online tutorial video taking you through the different steps you'll need to complete in order to create a professional looking research poster. Now, in this video we'll be using Microsoft PowerPoint 2010. You may have a slightly different version of the software. We would recommend working in PowerPoint as the functions are pretty simple to use and they are fairly similar across the different versions of the software. So hopefully you'll be able to follow along at home. Now, our first step is to go up to the top toolbar and select Design and page setup. This is going to allow us to set the dimensions for our research poster. Now we have the option of setting either portrait or landscape, so let's go for portrait. And now we need to sort out our sizing. Now for A1 we need to be at 59.4 centimeters wide and 84.1 centimeters tall. It's important to make sure we've got this set up right at the beginning so that our sizing is all correct. We don't want to be changing that around at the end. So, now that our sizing and dimensions are correct, we can begin to block our poster. Now, blocking a poster means to insert a series of shapes and boxes that will help us to visualise where our content will sit on our final poster. In order to do that, I'm going to go up to the Shapes option, and to begin with, I'll insert a large rectangle at the top of the poster. Now, this will be where our title lives, and it may seem like quite a large box at this stage, but remember, we are working in A1 size, so we do want a nice big title that's going to capture the reader's attention. Now what you can't see is that we are working on a double screen. So in addition to this PowerPoint window, we have got a Word document open with the content for our poster pre-filled in there. We've been working on it, cutting it down, getting it ready for the poster format. Now in that document, we've picked out four key sections that we want to include in our poster. So we're going to go for four even boxes, all of the same size. Now the reason for this is that we don't want one section to be longer than the other. We're aiming for a nice symmetrical poster in this case. A bit of a mess around here, just copying and pasting those boxes, editing the size slightly so that they sit nicely alongside each other. Now, one thing to think about as you design your poster and you begin to block it is your reading order. Now, you'll see that we've gone for two boxes at the top here and we're going to paste in a further two at the bottom. Now, it's worth thinking about for the reader, how will they work through the content in your poster? Will they work from left to right or will they work from top to bottom in a two-column format? We don't have to make this decision right now, but when we come to paste our content in, it is worth thinking about what order do we want those boxes to be presented to the reader in. That will help us to decide where do we put the background information and then the methodology. Now I'm just inserting a small box at the bottom here, and this is for our references. Now the references do need to be included in APA format on any poster, but they don't need to be in the same font size as the rest of the poster. So this box is a little bit smaller. We can get away with a smaller font size, perhaps around 20. As I say, it's important the references are there, but they don't need to be of equal size to the rest of the content. Now I'm thinking in this middle section, I might pop in maybe an image, a table or a graph. So I'm just going to pop a circle in there for now as a placeholder. Again, allow me to visualize the poster and figure out where do I want that imagery to sit. So I'm just going to have a little move around of some of the boxes here. I might fill these in to remind us that they are forming separate sections. So I'll go for yellow to denote our images. At the top here, I'll just fill our title box in green to differentiate it from the rest. And our references at the bottom, I'll pop in purple, I think, just to make them quite different from the rest. Now, as I say, we're aiming for a symmetrical layout for this poster. So I'm just going to move these boxes up slightly, leaving a fair bit of white space around the boxes at the moment, so there is an opportunity to make them slightly larger when that text is copied and pasted in. All right, so that's looking pretty good as a basic layout. So our next step is to start copying and pasting in our text. Now there's a couple of ways you could do this. You could drag and drop a text box in PowerPoint and copy and paste your content across. I think what we'll do is just to show you when you've inserted a shape, you can right click on that. And even though it is a flat shape, we can select Edit Text, converting it straight away into a text box. So let's copy and paste in our first section on background and aims. Now, one of the quirks of PowerPoint is that regardless of the size that your font is in the Word document, it always makes it bigger when you copy and paste it across. In this case, I think it's around 58. Now, as a rule, for research posters, we don't really want to go below size 30 font. Any smaller and it's going to become very difficult for the reader to read that content. And we don't want to overcrowd the poster. We want to make sure we're including concise information. So if we aim for a font size of around 30 to 32, we're hitting it about right there in terms of making it accessible for the reader and also keeping to a good level of content and word count. So I'm just going to do this step by step, copying and pasting in our different sections. So in the top left, I've got my background. And here I'm just setting out that this poster covers a case study dissertation. So there's a little bit about my method there in the bottom left hand corner. So for now, I'm going to work with a two column approach, and I want the reader to work through this top to bottom. So reading the top left box first and then encountering the method underneath. Similarly, I'm going to right click, edit text, and insert our information here on the results and discussion. Again, that text is a little bit bigger, so we're going to take that down to around 30 to 32. So that we can see as an absolute minimum how much space does that text fill. Now we did leave some quite large margins beforehand, so we can already see there is an option here to drag these boxes and make them a little bit larger. Do try and leave a bit of white space around the edges of the poster though for printing purposes. We don't want our text to be running right to the edges when it's sent to the print shop ready for the final design to be finished off and printed. So I'll just copy and paste in my future work here. So I've just got a small section on kind of conclusions and what comes next, and I'll edit the text there. Now, one thing we haven't done in this video, but you can do yourself, is to decide when you've inserted this text, will you differentiate between headings and keywords by using bold, possibly even underlined font? You may also want to consider the use of bullet points to break up your work, and thinking about different line spacing options to just move the work apart. We don't want it to feel too cramped in terms of the text. So there are a couple of things you can play around with at a later date when you're trying to get that text looking nicely filled in those boxes. Now I've got my references here. As I say, we can take these a little bit smaller. So keeping the same font style, we're in Arial. I'm going to drop that down, maybe into the 20s. If we go for size 20, we can see it's quite small. But again, there's not essential content in those references. It's important that they're there for the purposes of academic integrity, but they don't need to be the same size as those boxes. Now I've just inserted my title there. At the minute it's at 58, which may feel quite large, but I'm actually going to come back to that in a little while and make it bigger. But let's move on to thinking about this central section here with the images. Now I am copying and pasting in a graph here from Excel. Now we would recommend pasting this in from Excel as it's treated then as a live chart. That means that you can edit it in PowerPoint in the same way you would in Excel. You can change the bar style, the colours, the labels. If it's copy and pasted as a flat image, as this one is here, you can see as you begin to resize it, that can tend to distort the image somewhat. So with charts, it's always best to insert them from Excel so that they can be edited and cropped and changed in different ways. We don't want them to become pixelated or distorted when the size changes. Now, I've put those in there so that I've got a good idea of how much content needs to be covered in this poster, and now I can begin to change the sizing of my title. Now you'll see here, if we take it up to 80, it does still fit in that box. And we would recommend that for your title sizes, anywhere between 80 to 120 is a good font size to aim for. Now, one thing we are missing from this example is our name and our institution. And we might also want to think about inserting our email address. This is because posters can often kind of live on beyond an event, and people might want to use them as a networking tool, perhaps to get in touch with you and find out more about your research. So if we just mess around with the style here a little bit, you can see we could take that font size down to create space for your name and your email address if that's something you'd like to include. And we'd really encourage including your name on your poster, as it is your work and it does allow for people to find you after the event and maybe get in touch about your research, find out a little bit more about what you're doing. So I'm just going to drag these out a little bit towards the edges to give us some more space. And again, it helps us to decide, have we got a good balance of information across these sections? Now, we can see immediately that our methodology section is quite small. And one thing I might want to do later is come back to this and think about a more creative way to present that particular section, maybe with a flow diagram. I could use some icons and arrows just to introduce something a little bit different to that section. But what's nice with our column approach is that we can decide to keep our results and discussion at the top there, because those two sections at the top have got more content in them. There is an option, of course, to move these boxes around depending on our decided reading order, but that is going to be dictated by the word count on the page. So feel free to have a play around with these boxes and figure out what reading order works, where should the content go, and does it feel balanced to the eye? Rather than having quite large full text boxes next to smaller ones, have we got that sense of symmetry and balance that's going to be pleasing to the eye of the reader? So here I'm just going to adjust my chart size, and we can see because this is a live chart taken from Excel, it's reactive to being changed in terms of its size and its dimensions. It's not distorting those boxes, and it's keeping the text visible as well on those legends at the side there on the left hand side. Now I'm just moving these up because it's really important with any graphs and tables and images to remember that you won't always be stood next to your poster to present it. So we do need a small heading or a figure label that's going to help the reader to understand what do those graphs and charts mean when they're on this poster independently. Now I think in order to create a little bit more room for that, I'm just going to move around the references somewhat, make sure they're centered nicely in this box, and I can probably take them up to size 22, 24, let's go for 22. There we are. So they're not too scrunched up, but again, they're not taking up a disproportionate amount of space. Now, again, using the blocking technique, let's insert some shapes underneath our graph and our images so that we can place in our figures and our titles. Now, again, I'm going to try and keep this as symmetrical as possible. So I'll copy and paste that and drag it across. And use very similar conventions to what you would in a normal assignment. So, for example, you might use things like figure one or table one, figure A, depending on the system that you want to use. And I'm going to follow that here on my poster. So figure one, and we need a meaningful title now. So this figure shows reasons against cycling. So it's some participant responses and the reasons that they gave for not cycling in Sheffield. So I'm just going to keep that short and sweet, but also you'll notice no specialist terminology, no need to mention that this is qualitative data, etc. It just needs to be a meaningful title so that someone can quickly identify what is the key information being given to me in that particular graph. Similarly here, I want to give the source and attribute my image. So I don't need to say image one in this case, I just want to pop image source. And rather than creating a full APA reference, I'm just going to give the title of where that's come from. So you may give the name of the website, the author, the publication. In this case, we got it from the Cycle Sheffield website. Now there is a full reference to that image in the references at the bottom, but again, this is about communicating meaning. So we just want a quick snapshot, a short title that captures what that image is about. Okay, so we're ready now to start thinking about the background color. So from the design tab on the toolbar at the top, I select background styles, and I can here look at the different background formats. Now there's a range of different colors and different options open to us here. Let's click on the gradient fill, and you'll also see a series of preset colors, some of which are a little bit bright and bold, and we want to think really that background needs to be fairly neutral. What's important is that the work on top of it in terms of our content is what really stands out. So I'm going to opt for this light blue colour for now. There's some different options here on the fade out, so let's go for the top right hand corner. Lots of options in terms of setting the brightness and changing the colours that you fade into, but I'll keep it with the blue and white for now. The next important thing to consider is the contrast of your text against the background. Now, if we just quickly change the background of this box to white and the text to black, you can see straight away the contrast there of that text is improved. And that's what we want to be thinking about for the reader. In terms of the visuals of the poster, can they easily read and access our key information? Now, that black font on a white background is quite a strong contrast. I'm going to undo it and go back to the white on blue. It's a little bit more subtle. Now, one thing we would really encourage you to do when you're designing your posters is to use an online contrast checker to double check whether the font stands out enough against the background of your text boxes, and as well check the colour of your text boxes against the poster background, because we want some layers of colour and contrast there so that the reader can quickly see the information and take it in without being dazzled by the different colours that you've got on your poster. So that concludes this tutorial video. We hope you found it helpful. If you have any more questions, do check the description box of this video where you can find a link through to our online study guide, which should answer any immediate questions or concerns you might have. If you don't find the answer you're looking for there, you'll also see there's a link through to our email address. So please feel free to either email or tweet us with any questions you have about creating your own professional research poster.